It is really an honor to be a Kirby lecturer, and Wes wasn't kidding when he said the list of the first 25 people was an amazing list of the who's who in infectious diseases. So I feel absolutely privileged to be here. I always say that leadership is a privilege, and these are the kinds of situations that just make that all the more clear to me. It's not my first time giving grand rounds at Washington. I was here many years ago talking about occupational HIV prevention and how you go about avoiding getting HIV, hepatitis B, hepatitis C, or any number of other things through needle sticks. And I am really surprised and pleased to hear that the protocols that we invented on the fly with very little data are holding up to the test of time and have proven to be valuable. So sometimes when you have to make a decision with inadequate information, you turn out to be right. And that was a good lesson for me in retrospect, because we were afraid of what we were doing. It's not that easy to just give healthy people antiretroviral therapy for 6 weeks and not really know what's going to happen to them. So a lot of deja vu being back here. But I love to teach, and it's a great honor and privilege for me to be in this audience. And I have to, of course, start with why I'm here. What are my objectives, and what do I hope we can accomplish during this presentation? So I have four of them. I'd like to help people understand the competency challenges for our patients who are involved in health decisions. I'd like to describe the principles of narrative-based medical decision and how it complements evidence-based decisions. I'd like to really help people understand fully what plain language means and why it's so important for us as clinicians and communicators. And then finally, just to make sure people remember the rules that improve communication as any kind of communicator, but particularly as a clinician or as a public spokesperson. And I also need to fully acknowledge my conflicts of interest as well as my interests. I am a president of a business in the pharmaceutical sector, in the Merck vaccine business, and people often ask, why on earth would you go to a pharmaceutical company? And I really did make this decision because I am passionate about cervical cancer elimination. I've been all over Africa, and I've seen what you can do for pennies in terms of screening with vinegar and applying liquid nitrogen for just a few cents, that we can actually take the leading cause of cancer mortality among women in developing countries off the table for a small handful of change. And if we can complement that with immunization program of younger girls, we can have a profound impact on the global health of women, which is also a way of saying we can have a profound impact on the economic development in a lot of countries that are dependent on women and children being healthy and thriving. So it's a passion. But you can see I have a few other passions here too, including my nonprofit board work, and particularly the Merck Wellcome Trust Hillman Laboratories is a nonprofit joint venture in India that we chair to try to take vaccine products that were designed for rich countries and redesign them and reinvent them so that they work better and are cheaper to deliver and administer in poorer countries where the cold chain is a problem. So what's not mentioned here, and I should also acknowledge, is that I remain a member of the faculty at UCSF and San Francisco General Hospital, and up until at least so far, I've been able to go back and attend for a couple weeks every year on the infectious disease consult service. So my heart is still the heart of a clinician, and I love teaching, and I just love seeing students and fellows and bright young people here. So thank you so much for having me. Wes mentioned that my time in government service was characterized by a lot of public health crises, 43 to be exact, including SARS, monkeypox, avian influenza, West Nile, a whole number of hurricanes cascading the tsunami in Thailand. There was just one after another. And I, being actually a fairly introverted person, found myself thrust into the position of being a public spokesperson and still trying to run a very complex public health agency for which there were many strengths, but emergency preparedness on a global scale was not the strongest capability that CDC had at that time. And I had to learn how to be a better spokesperson than I was when I started out, and I got some help. And one of the people who helped me was a risk communicator named Vincent Cavello, and he taught me four rules of public communication in crisis that I, to this day, still recall. And I'm recalling them as I speak because Katie Couric did a story yesterday really inflaming some of the issues around HPV vaccination safety. And so once again, we're going to be doing some risk communication, try to put things into context for people. But these principles are very simple. Be first, be right, be credible, and most of all, be empathetic, which means people need to know you care or you can't possibly communicate effectively with them. And being first is important because if you don't put the information out first, somebody else will, and they might not have it as accurately as you do. It's important to be right because that's ultimately that's your goal, is to have the accurate information. Being credible is hard because you sometimes are out there with information that you don't have incomplete. As I said, with the occupational HIV protocol, we didn't have all the information, but we needed to try to sustain some credibility in these crises for the individual with a needle stick. But sometimes you also have to say, I can't tell you this right now. Or, yes, I do know what the security, National Security Council says about the potential for bioterror threats, but I can't discuss that with you right now. You have to tell the truth. And I think that's a really critical component of all of this. So when I thought about this, I realized that even with all this training, it was still hard for me to do. And the way I got through a lot of press conferences and a lot of things that were internally very, very difficult for me was to pretend that I was talking to a patient. So I would look out over a room full of pretty surly media members, and I would just find one, and I would think to myself, okay, that's my patient. Let me explain this to you as if you were my patient, and I will try to put it in context and give you information in the same way that I would at the bedside. And so in my mind, my public communication was really based on my clinician communication, because if you think about it, the principles are the same. It's important to our patients that they hear information from us first. It's important that we have accurate information. It's important that they trust us and see us as credible, honest brokers of the information that we do have. And if they don't think we care about them, it doesn't matter anything else that we say. So I really felt like my clinical experience helped me do a bit better job in my public spokesperson role. But now that I'm a little bit away from that, I've had a chance to look at it more objectively, and I think it goes beyond that. Because when you think about what is the function of public health communication and decision making, the function is pretty straightforward. What you're doing is taking information that you have about a population, whether a population of epidemiologic information about a health threat or a hurricane or tornado, whatever it is, and then you're translating that to have meaning to the individuals who are sitting in front of you and hopefully motivating them to make good decisions or take effective actions on behalf of protecting or improving their own health. So that paradigm of going from population, translating that to the individual, and then using that knowledge that you have as the communicator to help other people make decisions and motivate action is, again, exactly the same thing that we do at the bedside every day. We take population health information. We as clinicians have to put a lens on that, figure out how does this apply to this person who's needing my care today, and then help that person make a good set of decisions either on diagnosis or treatment or prevention activities, and hopefully get them to follow through and act on that experience. So I have come to conclude that the grand challenge in health is really this translational process, and that if we don't do it well as clinicians, we are not really going to be able to end up with patients who are benefiting as best as they can from our services. So our grand challenge is to translate science into solutions, data into decisions, and ultimately the ambiguity that all of this creates into effective actions to protect people and hopefully end up doing more harm than good, either for the individual or if it's a public situation for the general public. Now, when I trained, I think I started out kind of with this very simple model of how this works, which is there's a clinician and there's a patient, and you extract some information from the patient in the form of a history that we get in a very structured manner, and we integrate that with what we already know, with what data we get from test results and so on and so forth, and then we feed that analysis back to the patient with some framework to help him or her make an effective decision. So it's a bi-directional communication process, but it's fairly structured and, I think, now an oversimplified model. Because this translation of science into evidence and then evidence into decision-making is really only the beginning of the process. Good decision-making in this context requires that the patient actually have a fairly sophisticated understanding of risk and probabilities. They need to trust that the credibility of the source is there. They need to really understand in a complex way the condition or the threat that you're talking about. And they really have to be able to anticipate or prognosticate the result of the actions that you're recommending. In other words, they have to be able to contextualize the information that you're giving them, and you, in turn, have to be able to contextualize the information that they are providing to you. So this framework has led me to believe that we have to make a slightly advanced adjustment to the model, that the process of decision-making is not just about it goes this way and then it goes that way. It's happening in the context of a lot of other influences, and we're going to talk about those influences as we go forward. So I'd first like to focus on the patient and really think through from the patient's point of view, what is the relevant capability that is required for making good health decisions and then moving them into action. And there are some competencies that really help this process. It helps to have scientific literacy. It helps to have a broader health literacy, and it certainly helps to have numeracy, the ability to understand and interpret numbers and fractions and ratios. And of course, as we're dealing with an increasingly aging population, it also helps that we have a patient who's cognitive and is not disabled in terms of their ability to think and hear and see and respond quickly to learning and other sources of information. So let me talk a little bit first about scientific literacy. You know, it's a complex concept. These three frames of scientific literacy are helpful in sort of recognizing that there's a hierarchy of capability among people. We would be satisfied if people knew at least some foundational science, you know, the basic sort of biology 101 type activities and knowledge base. It's helpful to have people who know a little bit more about how science actually works, what the scientific method is, what a hypothesis is, how that process unfolds. And then ultimately, in our society, there are just a few rarefied people, mostly like people in this room, who understand how science really works, how science funding works, how scientific decisions get translated into policy, and how it is that we create constructs for debating the ethics of the scientific enterprises that we're engaged in. So as a country, how well do you think we do in any one of these domains? Well, I'm not optimistic. This is a Harris poll from 2009. About half of people know how long it takes the Earth to go around the sun. Only 60% of people know that humans and dinosaurs did not, you know, didn't really have Fred Flintstone and Dino. And most people don't really understand how much of the Earth is water. But more amazingly, only about 20% of people could answer all three questions. So that's where our starting point is for health decision making, is the culture that really does not have a sound grounding in scientific theory. I was in Ethiopia last year, and I visited the Ethiopian National Museum, where the archaeologic findings for the Rift Valley and the regions where many of the early hominids have been detected are exhibited. This is actually not Lucy. Lucy was in the United States at that time, but this is a replica of Lucy. You know, notice she's a very small woman. On the upper left-hand corner is a series of bones that really display the evolution of hominids and the current thinking about how humans develop from hominid lineages. And when you're standing there looking at that, and you know Lucy is 3.2 million years old, it's very hard to deny that there is a plausible rationale for the theory of evolution. However, 46% of Americans don't buy it. And it's not just Americans. The concern about evolution versus creationism has been becoming increasingly prominent in many societies and many religious and social constructs around the world. And when you think about it, it's really a very troubling concept in the light of what we're asking people to be able to do. I came across this highly credible source, a reviewer on Amazon.com who liked the book, but I just love the quote here because it just captures for me what I think is going on. Scientists get data and derive conclusions. Believers already have conclusions and selectively examine the data in that light. And that's really what we're seeing over and over again. If you believe something and you work backwards from it, you can end up in a position that's very different than if you're looking at data and drawing conclusions deductively. And what I think is going on is our science really has become incredibly complex. Stem cells are an incredibly complex concept. Many of the things that genomic, sequencing the human genome, this is incredibly difficult science for people to get their hands around or their heads around. And so what happens is when you really can't understand something, you default to the easiest explanation. So it's a gray or there's no gray. It's black or white. And if you can't get the gray, the confusion, the ambiguity, the complexity, you just default to the simplest possible answer. And the worst thing, the thing that confuses people the most, is when they see two scientists debating something. You know, in our world, that's healthy. And that's how we get innovation and discovery and new ideas. But if you're not familiar, if you're not grounded, if you're not scientifically literate, you watch that happening, it's frightening. And then what do people do? They throw up their hands, they say, well, the scientists can't even agree, it must be hogwash. And so you end up with these very extreme perspectives on things that are just too difficult for society to understand. So, he is really lucky to be alive. So when we're dealing with, a foundation that is not very strong, and then we're asking people to move into the realm of health and health literacy, we're stretching them sometimes beyond their capability. So let's talk a little bit about health literacy, which in a simple term is just the ability to take in and understand basic health information. It has to be contextualized again. We'll come back to that. But in our society, health literacy is also the exception and not the rule. About 14% of people are way below basic ability to understand simple health information, and only about 12% of our population would be what we consider proficient. Obviously, there's a strong correlation between socioeconomic attainment and people's ability to be literate in their health. And we need to assume that our patients are not health literate when we engage with them until proven otherwise, not the other way around. And a big part of this is numeracy, the ability to understand numbers. And if you think about all the things that we ask people to do, whether it's take their medicine right or reduce their portion size and their caloric intake or make medical decisions based on risks and probabilities, they really have to understand numbers. They have to understand proportions and fractions. They have to understand them in an area under a curve of timely decision making. And this is not easy. Again, there are a lot of challenges in this, and people in general really have very limited ability to use numbers effectively. Almost all Americans think that 1 in 10 is bigger than 10, and excuse me, that 1 in 10 is small, is bigger than 10 in 100, even though these numbers are exactly the same. 30% increase is bigger than an increase from 1 in 10,000 to 1.3 in 10,000. So people can't really understand the difference in that these ratios are actually expressing the same thing. And so because they have these misunderstandings, how you frame your data when you present it to them is going to make a big difference in what decision they make. So you can cause a patient to see a risk as high or low simply in the way that you present the numbers to them. So it's very important to recognize that what you recognize as a very simple mathematical construct is not so simple for the patient. I thought this quote really summed this up well. When they give you percentages or say you have a 70% chance of becoming a diabetic, I think back to school and, 70, that was a C. I'm okay. 70%, that ain't bad. That's the patient contextualizing that information and interpreting it from his own point of view. And when we think about what we're asking people to do today, quickly, go on this website, read a lot of information about health plans, take in a lot of information about costs and quality and risk and dollars and cents. We are asking the people who are signing up for this health plan to really be suddenly health literate, competent in numeracy, and ultimately make decisions that most of us would have trouble making. At least I have trouble making my own decisions about an insurance plan. So I think we owe it to our patients to really encourage them to use the guides and to get help in going through this process, the same way we did when we launched Medicare Part D, that it's just too complicated and people really deserve the opportunity to have the assistance and the help so that they can get the best possible value from the new plans and coverage that are available to them. And I'm not going to talk about aging and physical cognition and all of this, but I just wanted to kind of paint the picture for you that when we expect patients to come to a decision prepared to incorporate the information that we're delivering to them, we are expecting a lot, even for the most simple decisions. And people are imperfect. Their knowledge of science and health literacy are incomplete. And they really don't have often the capabilities to do this well. But it's not just about the challenges that the patient has. In many cases, when we're not communicating well, it's a problem with the transmitter, not the receiver. We don't really understand our patient. And we use jargon or language or present information in biased ways that really undermines their ability to think objectively about the decisions that they're making. We also often speak before we listen, and we undermine our own credibility in the process. So let's talk a little bit more about the clinician side of the equation here. Now, many people have studied medical decisions, and one of the ways of determining if a decision was good or if communication was effective is by actually asking the patients. So there's some very large scale and very excellent studies that have been done in this regard. And this newspaper summary of some of them, I think, captures the flavor of most of the findings that most patients really can't recall even the major risk associated with a proposed operation or procedure. 44% of patients don't even know what their operation was when they go into the operating room. And, of course, we all know that nobody reads the consent form. 80% of what doctors tell patients is forgotten by the time people leave the office. And half of what they do remember is wrong. So we're, you know, fooling ourselves if we think that we've really been effective at imparting the kind of information that we want people to be able to take home and use to change their behavior or make good and better decisions. And I think some of this has to do with the mental model that I see all the time. I see it at Merck. I certainly saw it at CDC. I saw it at UCSF. And that's the concept that if people just knew more, they would make better decisions. We need to educate the patient. So if the patient has better education, the patient has more information, the patient will be able to do the right thing, they will want to do the right thing, and they will be successful in doing the right thing. So this is the kind of no-do model of health decisions. And the reason why I think we are especially comfortable in the no-do model is because we've been trained to think like scientists. We're scientists. We're medical professionals, and we have been trained in a certain paradigm of thought and decision-making that's based on, you know, the rational approach. What am I doing today? I'm standing in front of a PowerPoint presentation. How do we make decisions? We get data. We have a hypothesis, we get data, we have materials and methods, we have a very structured way of examining those data, we draw conclusions, we discuss those conclusions, and then we summarize them in nice, colorful PowerPoint presentations, and we share that information very effectively, or hope very effectively, in this room or rooms like this. So when scientists communicate with other scientists and when doctors communicate with other doctors, we're probably pretty good communicators because we're all thinking and feeling and dealing with things in the same way. The problem comes when we have to translate that methodology into the context of the patient's world. And what I would say is, from a patient's point of view, knowing is not enough. If knowing was the answer, no one would smoke cigarettes. And yet, as I was walking around the University of Washington campus yesterday, I was appalled at how many smoke shops, electronic cigarettes, hookah pipes, and all kinds of probably other pipes that I saw on the campus. So, you know, it's not enough to know what is a good health decision. There's something else that has to go on in the process. And I think that when you're trying to bring science to regular people, to non-scientists, so to speak, that the way most people make decisions in their day-to-day lives or even in their health lives is a little bit different. The first thing is people want to get to the bottom line. What is the key thing that I need to know? Give me the message. And yes, many are interested in, well, are you sure? How do you know that? That's not what I've heard. But a very important part of how decisions are made by regular people is the contextual environment that they experience in their own life. What's going on around them? Who's influencing them? And so on and so forth. And again, I will come back to this contextual situation. And they have their own definition of what is a trusted authority, and it's not necessarily us. So when you're dealing with people who approach decisions this way, you know, it's not a PowerPoint. You know, if you want your teenager to wear a helmet when they're on a motorcycle, you don't give them a PowerPoint presentation, right? You have a different strategy for influencing the decisions that you're trying to convince them to make. But let's talk first about the message, because I think this is a very important part. When scientists are communicating, we love ambiguity. We love variance. We love exceptions to the rule. But when we translate information for other people, they don't want all that noise around the translation. Most people really just want to know, well, what are you saying? What does it mean? Give me the bottom line. They want the SACO, the single overriding communication objective. This is true in public speaking, and I think it's also true when we're engaging with our patients. It's what we as the clinician would like the patient to understand or do or think about doing in the context of the discussion. And sometimes we can even get that broken down into an easy-to-remember soundbite, which is the minimum amount of sound necessary to make sense, according to Mark Twain, but is a short sentence or a pithy little statement that helps people remember things and will trigger a broader understanding in the mind of the individual who can remember the soundbite. And here are some soundbites that have been relevant to me in my career. You know, the concept that less is best in antibiotics, or meth is death, which came up actually with Senator Baucus, who was doing a hearing in Washington on, you know, the difficulty with methamphetamine use and his energy around that in the state of Montana. In Washington, Idaho, in this area, there's a lot of methamphetamine issue in the rural areas, as you know, no doubt know. So I was with Senator Baucus, and we were not in Montana, actually, we were in Washington, but he was asking me as the CDC director to make some comments, and this soundbite just popped out of my mouth. I didn't even know it was coming. I just said, well, meth is death. Headlines in the newspaper the next day, CDC director, meth is death. So, you know, you got to be careful how you use a soundbite, because it can definitely come back to haunt you. But, you know, it is sometimes useful in your own mind to think of the soundbite, because it helps you get to the most important message that you want to deliver to the patient. And it's not easy to do. You know, you have to put a lot of work into this. I love this quote from Albert Einstein, who's one of my heroes, that most of the fundamental ideas of science are essentially simple and may, as a rule, be expressed in a language that's comprehensible to everyone. You know, think about a brilliant scientific discovery. Think about PCR, for example, or DNA. You know, when we finally understood the double helix, it's such a simple concept. It's so beautiful in its simplicity. And much of science can be expressed in a very almost pure platonic sort of simple beauty if we put a little bit more time into thinking how we rearrange our conversation to help others see through all of the complexity and get to the core idea that we're talking about. One of the important tools to help with this is a theory of communication or an approach to communication called plain language. Is everyone here familiar with plain language? So This is a style of communication that is the opposite of what you would normally read in a legal document, a consent form, or many of the other information tools that you might use on a day-to-day basis. It is communication that's meant to have as few words as possible. It's meant to be brief, to the point, concise, and easily understood. And it's a style of communication that was championed by Al Gore when he was the vice president. And so the government was required during that administration to initiate plain language activities. But it's not limited to the government. It's just that the government made it serious and reinvented a number of their forms and regulations and so forth to be presented in plain language. So let me illustrate plain language. If the point, the message, the SACO that I'm trying to communicate is more night jobs would keep youths off the street, one of the non-plain language strategies is to refer to studies, studies have found, or to replace simple words with long words. Additional nocturnal employment would keep adolescents off thoroughfares, or use vague, sophisticated verbs, identified the fact that, or using various adjectives, various applicable available studies, additional appropriate nocturnal employment, or using weasel words, a number of generally, usually keep adolescents off most thoroughfares, using redundancy, let's keep the juvenile adolescents off the thoroughfares, and adding meaningless clauses. This was very common in some guidelines that I used to be responsible for. There is no escaping the fact that it may be considered important to note, or it may be prudent to consider. That was one of my favorite ones in government. Using legalisms, including but not limited to the time prior to midnight and weekends and or 2 a.m. on weekends, using foreign words ipso facto. So what you end up with is there's no escaping the fact that it's considered very important to note that a number of various applicable available studies ipso facto have generally identified the fact that additional appropriate nocturnal employment would usually keep juvenile adolescents off most thoroughfares, including but not limited to the time prior to midnight and weekends and at 2 a.m. on weekends. So it's a statement, and if you took the time to read it, you would conclude that more night jobs would keep youth off the street. So obviously this is an exaggerated example, but the point is we do this all the time. We do it in our scientific writing, we do it in our day-to-day communication, we do it in our forms, and we need to really be vigilant about stopping that, because it wastes paper, among other things, but it definitely obscures effective communication. These are some examples where plain language has been introduced into government. The old label for an allergy tablet, look at the fine print, not very much white space, very difficult to grab the information that you might want out of that, versus this version over here, which has the drug facts very clearly. What are the directions down here? Fairly straightforward. If you're adult, if you're a child, if you're under six, ask a doctor. Very simple instructions, much more accessible to people with low health literacy and numeracy. I'm not perfect, but certainly an improvement in the right direction. So plain language to me, in my soundbite, is less is best. Again, it's just a way of communicating the very core that you're trying to express without doctoring it up with a lot of other things and using the simplest possible language and the minimum number of technical terms, or if you have to use them, to use them and define them. And it's not just about written communication. It also applies to patient aids, things we use to help patients, or in this case, health workers, do the right thing. Is this a good plain language document? Well, maybe not. First of all, when you look at the graphic, what does that mean? People grabbing water. Like, that's kind of an obscure concept to me. I don't quite get it. And then, you know, lots of small print, you know, have to read lots of words per line. It's not a particularly user-friendly graphic. This one might be a little bit better. Clean hands save lives. You kind of see something about what they're talking about. I don't really know what the red lines are doing, but it's getting you there. Or something like this, which is very simple. Start here. Wet your hands. Soap 20 seconds. Scrub, rinse, towel dry. Turn off the water. Not too ambiguous. Most people who understand English, at least, would be able to follow these instructions and know the best way to dry their hands. So it's a simple tool in plain language for people. Now, let's talk about how this actually plays out in real life, because I've mentioned how the patient is or is not prepared to participate effectively in a decision process, how the clinician can improve his or her ability to present information to that patient. But the most important thing here really is the context, and particularly the patient's context and how they go about using their contextual framework to modify what they're hearing, seeing, thinking in the course of the decision process. So the clinician, on the one hand, is empowered with the knowledge of pathogenesis and diagnosis and what are the treatment options, what have the test results shown, what are the various treatment opportunities now, and what are the probable outcomes of those treatments for this patient, what's the prognosis, and how can we put all this together in a way that makes sense for this patient. The patient is sitting there in a very different mindset. The patient is thinking about their own, they know their values, they have expertise in their personal preferences, how they experience illness or pain or inconvenience, what are the most important factors in their life that are going to determine whether they can accept a particular kind of treatment, what are they most afraid of, what is their attitude about risk in general, and what are the special circumstances that they have to consider when they're making a decision. And I remember at the county when we were initiating broader access to antiretroviral therapy and we wanted women to take prophylaxis to prevent transmission to their children. And we needed women to come to the clinic to receive their evaluation and their ongoing care, but they wouldn't show up in the clinic. And, you know, sometimes people would say, well, it's an injection drug user, and what do you expect? And, you know, this is just the chaotic life that they live. But if you really sat down, the main reason that most women did not take antiretroviral therapy wasn't because they didn't know it would help protect their unborn baby. It's because they had other babies. They didn't have babysitters. They didn't have a place to live the children that they already had. And so they were not able to come to the clinic because they didn't have childcare. So the context of the decision for that patient had very little to do with the probability that their next child would be born with or without HIV infection. It had to do with their situation, with the reality that they were facing. And of course, this goes on time and time again, but we don't necessarily know that when we're involved in a medical decision. And so I have to think about how can we be better prepared to understand the patient's expertise. How can we understand the context in which they're coming to some of these important decisions? Now, social context is a huge and complex area where all the social connections that people have, all of the things they hear, see, of course, the digital social context is really extreme. And it plays out in a lot of different ways. This is just one study where people were trying to understand how social networks influence the decision to vaccinate. And to make a long story short here, you know, people increasingly are hesitating to get kids vaccinated, not just in Seattle and Washington, but around the country. And almost all parents consult with non-medical professionals about the vaccine decision. And what they found was if the person they consulted said you should get vaccinated, they were pretty likely to vaccinate their child. But if the person said, no, you shouldn't be vaccinated, they were much more likely not to vaccinate their child. So the trusted, socially relevant context for that parent was an important determinant of whether or not the child did or did not ultimately get vaccinated. So that's, to me, obviously a very serious concern, but it is something that happens over and over again in most of the medical decisions that people are facing. I've already presented this paradigm for how we reframe our communication context to patients. But it turns out that there's a theory, and I think now quite a bit of evidence to support it, that instead of using PowerPoints or narrative aids that have a lot of facts and figures and numbers on them, there's a better way to actually communicate with patients. And that's to use the power of narrative, the storytelling power of understanding what is the patient's story. And I realize this seems odd for us who work in an objective framework, but actually if you take yourself out of your role as a clinician, put yourself in the role of a person, a human being in life, we all have a narrative about our life. You know, I told you my narrative of being a public spokesperson and thinking about, well, gee, that's just like being a clinician. That's part of my personal narrative. There are many narratives that we could go on about, but people use their internal storytelling to make sense out of their lives, to try to anticipate, to make their own personal decisions. It's just the way humans interact and connect and put their life into a broad picture. So when we're thinking about how to help a patient make a good decision, it's important that we be able to do both things, that we provide objective information and our best kind of assessment and analysis of the evidence that we have for them, but we also need to be able to help them see how people like them might cope with a decision, or what does it experience of a person like them or not like them when they're facing with this decision. So let's bring it to a specific example. Let's say that people are trying to make a decision around mammography, and a left brain approach to this would be to present something like this. Now, I personally find this a bit confusing. It's 1 in 69, 1 in 6, 40%, 3 out of 4, 30%. These are not that easy to make sense out of, should I get a mammogram or not get a mammogram? It's a little bit tricky. But what if, in addition or instead of this kind of typical patient aid, we had a video or some kind of a process by which a woman who is also making the mammography story could tell her story? And if the story said, and I'm so glad I did because they found carcinoma in situ and I was able to take care of it, and now 6 years later I'm still in good shape, that's going to be a lot more contextually relevant to the person who's making the decision than something that is not involving emotions and playing into the story that she's playing. So, you know, we don't want to not provide factual information, but we need to also put ourselves in the minds and the shoes of the person who's making the decision and try to understand better how he or she is thinking about the decision that they're making and what it would mean to them. The people who usually do this best are oncologists. And the NCI is actually, there's a great reference, a review article that they've done where they've taken the narrative-based medicine and seen how it would apply to all the stages of cancer prevention, detection, diagnosis, treatment, survival, and end-of-life care, and really recognizing that the ability to bring narrative into the decision-making process is an extremely powerful tool. It also brings up ethical issues, because just as you can bias decisions with numbers in people with low numeracy, you can also bias people's decisions by what narrative you choose to put in front of them and how much you frighten them or how much you reassure them. So it's not like it's easy, but it's something that I'm just trying to plant a seed here, that pay attention, because there's a lot of really interesting literature, and I think increasingly people are seeing that this is part of humanitarian care, and that we as clinicians need to be able to do both things well, to use the PowerPoints, but also to be able to participate in the storytelling. And sometimes just the simple fact that patients do have a story is an important step in the right direction, because while we're taking our history, we often attenuate the narrative. And truthfully, the patient's story is usually much bigger, much richer, and much broader, and not necessarily much longer than we think we have time to hear. So a few more minutes listening to the story is not only helping you have your context for decision making more fully informed, but it's probably also going back to those four rules of effective clinician. It's being empathetic, allowing that emotional identification to occur, and sustaining and increasing your own credibility as a care provider and a person who's of service to a patient. So I'll stop here and take some questions, but I just hope that I've been able to give you a little bit of a broader view on decision-making communication, how I think about it, and address the objectives that I said I would try to object. Thank you. Thank you.